sure appreciate y'all doing this today. Our folks are anxious to hear from you. Thank everyone today for joining us. I'm Mary Kay Woodworth, and I'm the Executive Director of the Georgia Urban Ag Council. I know most of the people on this call, and it's great to see you. It's been too long since I've seen most of you. We are honored to welcome our special guest today, Congressman Doug Collins from the Georgia 9th District, Gainesville, and Congressman Drew Ferguson from Georgia 3rd District, West Point. We greatly appreciate you taking the time to meet with us and our members. Know you're headed to the swamp again in the morning. And before asking questions, we invite both of you to say a few words.
It's good to be here this morning and getting going. And yeah, the craziness in D.C. continues. You'll witness a little bit of that more tomorrow. I think that we have, sort of delved into Shakespearean territory here, more Macbeth. Congress has now unfortunately become a stage full of sound and fury signifying nothing in the last little bit because we're not able to get what we need to get done. But I just want to say a special note. The help with the face shields from Scott's and through y'all helping for our hospitals, I just want to say again, thank y'all for helping facilitate those. That has been very helpful to a lot of folks, and just wanted to make mention of that. We're looking forward to the fall and seeing, again, what we can actually get accomplished. And Drew's done such a great job. It's great to partner with him on a lot of these issues, especially with urban ag and the things that we see, moving together, because it has been a difficult time this year and trying to make sure that our businesses and business models can continue as we go forward. So I'm looking forward to answering some questions. I know the gamut from business to immigration, so I'll be happy to and turn it to Drew.
Dale, thanks, Doug, and thanks to each of you for taking time to be on this call today. It's as Doug pointed out, it's unusual times, but I'm optimistic about the future. I see light at the end of the tunnel on several fronts, and I get a sense that this pandemic and the effects of it are, I think we're closer to the end of it than we are the beginning. And I say that because we're seeing the economy rebound, and particularly in states like Georgia, where things have opened up. We are so much stronger here than we are than say Michigan or North Carolina or California. Our business community is figuring out a way to survive. I know it's not easy, but we've got a fighting chance here. Look, we've got some real issues coming up regarding the next COVID relief package and how difficult I think that's going to be to actually get something across the finish line, but I do think there will be some other opportunities to make some modifications to what we already have in place. Some of those include looking at extensions of the PPP loan program, greatly scaling back the $600 a week enhanced unemployment benefits, and quite candidly, we recognize that we've got to have some work done in our legal immigration system as well from a workforce standpoint. But bottom line, I when I look out and I see the chance for us to have a vaccine by the end of the year that is safe and effective, we're pretty optimistic that between that and the therapeutics and the capacity that we've built within our healthcare system, that America should be able to reopen, it should be able to return, and America can get back to living its dream. So with that, Mary Kay, I'll turn it back over to you.
Thank you. That is great positive news and something to really look forward to as we move through the fall and the winter. Well, let's just dive into the few questions that we do have and some of the things you've already talked about briefly. COVID-19 has affected every Georgia citizen and had an impact on all of our businesses, employees, and their families. Fortunately, most of our businesses had been able to put protocols in place that allow their operations to continue throughout the spring and summer and through into the fall. We appreciate that Congress acted to financially support small business, and many companies in our industry utilize PPP and EIDL, among other federal and state grants and loans. So we asked our members two questions regarding PPP and unemployment assistance. And the first was, did you or a business you know utilize Payment Protection Plan passed by Congress? 79% of the respondents said yes. 21% said no, or they were not sure. So they were may have been employees, not business owners. Secondly, Congress provided unemployment benefits of the additional $600 per week, which ended on August 1st. And we asked them if they believed extending the payment would help workers and stabilize the economy. 18% of respondents said yes. 82% responded they felt the extension would discourage workers from taking readily available jobs. So where are we now regarding the extension or changes to the programs? What can employers expect?
Well, Doug, I'll start with this one. So currently the CARES money and the timeline for what we did in Congress and what we appropriated ended at the end of July. Since that time, the president, as you know, has taken executive action and will be, and has, through the Emergency Powers Act, has said that he can do the enhanced unemployment at a 75% match to states up to $400. So that means that if a state's gonna participate, they're gonna have to put in $100 and the federal government will come in with $300. And a few states have done that. That money is being drawn down from a disaster relief fund that we typically use for hurricanes, forest fires, those kinds of things. That fund will be drawn down until it reaches $25 billion. So you could see this extend probably through the end of September, maybe into the first week of October, and then I think the money runs out. The Senate right now is working on what they call a skinny relief package. They have in there a $300 a month, a $300 a week bump in unemployment through the end of the year. I think the chances of getting that skinny package through the Senate are slim and none. But I do think that those are markers that are being put down that could be negotiated and applied at the end of the year continuing resolution, which will be in September. So the big CR package that will be there will probably be the chance for that to move. Bottom line, I think the fact that that you're seeing the unemployment run out, you're seeing more people go back to work, you're seeing more people go back and take the jobs that are available, and they are in every single sector. And most businesses are telling us that the limiting factor to their growth right now is, in fact, access to employees.
Yep. Drew did a great job explaining that, and I think the only two things I'll say is that some of this stuff doesn't need to be all financial. There's a liability protection that needs to be put in here as well, because you have employees who employers who've done what they need to do to make sure their employees are safe, but yet still have this fear that they will be sued or that their businesses will be held hostage on some of the liability issues. And that's not really a financial thing that we could do. We could actually have done that before. Unfortunately, we have not got it done. But I agree, such a disincentive, and it's from one end of the state, all sectors. I mean, when you're making $200 and $300 more a week than you were making before COVID hit, I just got off a call just a little bit ago with folks who were in the temporary business, in employment agencies, and they're calling people, and the people are being honest with them. They're saying, "Look, as long as I'm still getting extra money, I'm not going back to work." So those are the things we've got to work on. My concern in this election year is it's become a posturing note for bigger policy issues. And this is something for every business and person to think about. A $15 minimum wage, a $600 added on addition to the federal grant for unemployment insurance is a first step toward either a much higher federal minimum wage or a basic universal income. And I know that sounds crazy, but think about it for just a second. If all of a sudden we've allowed it to happen to where we're using funds to fund a basic income, a $600 or $1,000, even though it was tied to unemployment, what's to say that we couldn't decouple it from unemployment and try something else? This is a bigger, from my old training theological discussion than it is anything else right now. So this is something we've got to look at as we go forward. So I'm hopeful we will not just rush to fill the need of those who we can help by trying to do it with everybody. I think that's become the biggest issue. There's some that need this help. There's industries out there that have frankly needed everything they could, and they're still struggling. But then there are other industries who are just needing to come back to work.
Thank you for that. Labor is the biggest challenge, like you said, for many industries, and it has traditionally been very difficult in our industry. Even when we have these higher unemployment numbers, our members wonder if the majority of congressmen and women know that we have these challenges. Are they aware of it? I mean, when we did a poll of our members on this, we asked them, what's the status of your need for employees over just the last few weeks? 36% said they're fully staffed. 50% need more workers to meet current demand, 50%. And then 14% say they could grow businesses if they had workers available. The fact that they don't have workers is stifling their business growth. Do you think that Congress understands that?
So I'll jump in with that one. Absolutely, we understand it, at least on the Republican side of the aisle, we do. If you look at policies that we've tried to introduce into this conversation from the Ways and Means Committee, they're all pro-growth policies, trying to address some of the things that you just discussed. You know, how do we have a safe and secure workplace? How do we get our kids back into school? All of the issues that you're facing around the unemployment insurance, and we're fighting to correct those things right now. The challenge that both Doug and I have right now is we're in the minority, and we in the majority, and Speaker Pelosi right now, quite candidly, are not willing to have those meaningful discussions. They are about pushing the envelope as far to the left as they possibly can and going after policies that have nothing to do with the price of eggs. That's about as blunt as I can say it. You ask the question, are we aware of it? Absolutely. We just hope the voters are able to see through and see who is really trying to help address these issues from a legislative standpoint, a practical standpoint, and understanding. I put myself in the shoes of small business owners. I owned a small business, owned multiple small businesses, including my dental practice here in West Point, Georgia for 25 years. And I think to myself, what would it be like if I were in practice today? And I tell you, I'd be having the same troubles. It's about finding employees. It's about getting people to come to work. Making sure, quite candidly, that our kids are back in school in a safe and sensible way so that parents can go back to work. I mean, it's a great injustice that we're doing to this generation, keeping these young people out of the classroom, keeping them isolated, keeping them away from their friends and their educators. It is a real problem for American families, which means it's a real problem for business as well. So yes, we're aware of it, we're fighting it. I hate that we're having to have a fight about things that make sense that we should be doing.
Yeah, it just goes back to the old saying that my grandma told me years ago, common sense ain't common. And, you know, that's what we're dealing with in trying to deal with some of these, you know, packages and plans from as we're going through. I think Drew hit on it, and I'm not going to belabor it because you did a good job with this. I mean, but there's too many things that are accessory items to things that they're wanting to add into some of these discussions on, the problems that the businesses are having right now. I mean, look, we got to worry about, are the wheels rolling? Is the engine crank, and can the car get down the road? Then we'll start talking about, you know, did we get leather seats, or do we need an FM stereo in the car? We just need it to roll right now. We need businesses out, the working, and then we can discuss these other things later. And to try and throw them in right now is a disservice to Americans all across the country, especially those who are just trying to get out and go to work and don't know how to deal with the multitude of issues. And I'm sure you'll ask about it later, but this is also not just an employment base for our Americans. It's also our immigration issues, especially H-2A, H-2B. There's had to have the moratoriums, but they are allowing some guest workers to stay longer, which is helping us out. But that was a fight that we had. I mean, I was deeply involved in that from the judiciary perspective. The first few months of this is just trying to make sure that our some of our workforces who depended on that had those workers coming in, and that was tough.